When they're talking about Vietnam War, they talk about American against the Vietnamese communists. The American fighting the Vietnamese communists, that's the war in Vietnam. That's wrong. They forget about us. You come in to help me, to help us, to fight against that bad guy.
When I was a company commander, if I decided that I wanted to take out a village, I could do it with airstrikes, artillery, and infantry assault. No problem.
We'd have to drag them out of the buses, and they would be pretty bad, you know, burnt and charred and broken. And it was a pretty sick experience. Stuff that you don't like, want to live with, actually.
I was the only person on the base that was openly talking against the Vietnam War. I didn't make any bones about it. I didn't care. I felt totally justified in what I was saying.
This may shock people to hear, but I actually enjoyed the Vietnam War. It was the defining part of my life. And I went and I fought it, and I fought it well.
When recruits arrive at the Basic Combat Training Center, most of them are not up to the physical requirements of soldiering. That's why they need the benefits of the physical fitness program.
I was a Kennedy follower, actually, as a Kennedy youth. When he said, ask not what you can do, I, you know, bet on that and felt compelled to go ahead and serve in the Marine Corps.
I was 17 years old. I saw the poster for a paratrooper. And I went down to Inglewood, California, and this old overweight staff sergeant was in there eating his lunch at his desk. And I walked in the front door and he said, a dropout, right? I said, right. And so I signed up to be a paratrooper in the Army.
I was an infantry officer in the Vietnam War. I volunteered for OCS, infantry officer OCS, volunteered for Ranger School, volunteered for this tracker program, volunteered to extend one time for 6 months, volunteered to extend a second time for 6 months. I wanted to win the damn thing. And then finally, you know, at the end of about 24 months over there, it started to sink in, you know, I don't think we're gonna get this job done.
I was in the Air Force from 66 to 70. Starting as a second lieutenant, my first 2 years was a white collar plus job in Washington, D.C. at Headquarters Air Force. I continued law school, actually, because I'd been going to law school in Washington. It was kind of like, I couldn't believe I had such a soft assignment.
I finagled a way to deliver a seaplane to Da Nang, a two-engine Albatross Grumman seaplane. And I wore a patch then that had a guardian angel with his wings around the world, and our motto was we serve that others may live.
In 1954, I was mobilized into the Army. The gendarmerie, that means another kind of police, like a sheriff here, come to my house and they pick me to the truck and join the Army.
History is on the side of freedom. History does not favor a single system or belief unless force is used to make it so. Tonight, as so many nights before, the American nation is asked to sacrifice the blood of its children and the fruits of its labor for the love of its freedom.
The United States became involved in Vietnam, really at the end of World War II, when it was Indochina, when it was the French colony, which consisted of Vietnam, Laos, and Cambodia.
Vietnamese people served the government of France at that time. They want the power. We don't think that fair. The French cannot control Vietnam anymore.
It was an oppressed state. The French French lived there as overlords. The Vietnamese people were almost slaves under the French system.
Roosevelt and Churchill had met in the Atlantic and drawn up the Atlantic Charter, which called for the self-determination of nations. And the idea was that the war against Hitler was going to be the end of colonialism in the world.
That's what we believe in. We must reach that goal. They call Tam Dân Chủ Nghĩa, means the people's rights must be freedom. Dân Sinh Hạnh Phúc means the people's life must be a happiness. Dân Tộc Độc Lập means the people must be independent from foreign power. We want self-determination for our country.
Ironically, very soon, that principle of self-determination was immediately destroyed by France and the United States.
The war was finally ended with the Paris Accords in July of 54.
According to the accord, the Vietnam country divided in half. They said that that's a temporary situation. After 2 years, they must have a general election to unify the two parts together to make it one country. It never happened.
The United States went to strenuous efforts to make sure that there would be no election held in Vietnam because they were sure that the election would be won by Ho Chi Minh.
Ho Chi Minh thought that if the election, they conduct election at that time, he would win. But personally, I live on both sides, I don't think so.
Ho Chi Minh, who was sort of considered like the George Washington of Vietnam, he became the object of attack by the American government.
I think the United States was in no mood and did not feel that it had to allow the emergence of independent nationalist revolutionary movements in the world.
Vietnam was a natural extension of trying to do something to contain the growth of communism around the world.
Remember what happened then. In 1949, Mao Zedong took over China. 1950, the Korean War started. 1956, the Hungarian Revolution was crushed. In 1959, 1960, Fidel Castro took over in Cuba. So there was fear, I think, across the land that this was just part of the global onslaught by global communism.
We have carried our quest for peace to many nations and peoples because we share this planet with others whose future in large measure is tied to our own action.
So while the United States had been involved in the 1950s, helping the French, strong involvement in Vietnam began in 1964 with the Gulf of Tonkin episode in which presumably American destroyers had been attacked by North Vietnamese PT boats in the Gulf of Tonkin and later turning out to be a story full of deceptions. But it became the excuse really for the United States to go full scale into Vietnam.
The vessel called Maddox in the Gulf of Tonkin, they report that they get attacked by the Vietnamese communists, and that's the reason the United States must retaliate.
At that point, it doesn't seem like, when you look at the history, that there was even an attack on those 2 days.
That's just a creation of the situation in order for the United States to have a right cause to get involved directly instead of just advisory group.
And without any investigations, President Johnson called for military action, Congress responded, and the escalation of American involvement in Vietnam began.
The dream, of course, was that we were going to be there for a while, train them to fight, they would take over, we would leave. That did not happen.
Had Americans known these things, that we were facing a very, very proud, strong, nationalistic people with several hundred years of history of warfare against outsiders, it might have caused some American hesitation. Eventually, the New York Times sent a correspondent, and he proved beyond any doubt that the American bombing was affecting civilians, and it was not possible to just hit military targets. The whole country was completely honeycombed with bomb shelters. People were wearing hats that protected them from the fragments from the cluster bombs. It was easy to conclude that if civilians weren't the target, there certainly was no way to avoid massive civilian destruction, because we were at war with North Vietnam, not with an army or a truck convoy. We were at war with a very broad-based government and society.
I was at a base that was actually still considered a Vietnamese air base, Binh Tui. And the Vietnamese base commander asked me to go to make sure that the South Vietnamese pilots that had been trained in Mississippi were in fact hitting their targets, targets being villages. It was just total carnage. These villages are very tiny. Everybody was either dead or on the ground moaning and just barely moving. The water buffalo were either dead or moaning with these big gaping holes in their bellies. I saw these bodies, mostly young women and children holding, and you could tell they had been trying to flee the bombing. I threw up, and then I started crying. And the Vietnamese lieutenant, he said, "Why are you crying, Lieutenant?" I said something that I don't know where it came from, something like, as I was kind of shaking, "This is my family." Now, where that came from, it must have been an ancient place, because I didn't think I had that kind of a philosophy. And he laughed and said, "Lieutenant, this is a success."
That's why Vietnam veterans felt guilty, because in order to survive, so many people had to die. I got this camera on leave in Singapore, so I showed those pictures to the kids. The kids would always be so shocked and point out the ones that were no longer alive, the ones that died. You had to feel a lot of guilt around about living and seeing women and children die. Think of it with your own family, and you're trying to protect your own family and seeing them destroyed because of your behavior.
Americans began seeing on television pictures of American Marines setting fire to huts of Vietnamese peasants, and the villages burning while little clusters of families of men, old people, women, children stood around terrified.
Okay, a hooch goes up in flames. Was there a firefight? Had one just ended? Had six or eight guys got shot? Wow, that's a little different story.
My nickname was Zippo. If you shot at me out of your house, believe me, I would burn it to the ground and move you to a refugee camp.
A lot of it was rage. I mean, a lot of the times you knew that it was a VC-dominated village. You had reason to believe that it was. Either you'd been shot at there before, you just got shot at, you'd got an intelligence report that this village that looks all innocuous here with nothing but cute little old ladies and no males of military age is harmless, but you just know it isn't. And if there are incidents, there's shots fired, exchange of gunfire, whatever it is, then we start to, you know, work over the place a little bit. But, I mean, I guess that's better than killing people.
When the news of the My Lai massacre came and Life magazine pictures appeared showing American GIs pouring automatic rifle fire into trenches where Vietnamese women were, I think this had a powerful effect on American public opinion.
Anyone who thinks that that was a common everyday occurrence in Vietnam, or that infantrymen went out doing that type of thing, is totally fallible.
My life was a bunch of sick people. Man, I don't think there are any military people or any human being really that would condone shooting a baby. And even in the hottest of combats, we were there to protect these people, not to hurt them. And we always had that in our mind. In the battles, it was hard to tell sometimes who was who.
You cannot see the enemy. The enemy is civilian, just like you now. You may be an enemy, you may be a friend. You cannot tell who's the enemy. The Vietnamese can.
Don't put anybody on the ground who can't speak Vietnamese. Would there have been a My Lai if Cali had understood Vietnamese? When a monk is saying, I'm a man of the cloth, I'm a cleric, I'm a monk, please? If he heard little boys screaming, don't hurt my brother, don't hurt my brother, would he have machine gunned them both on the ground with the little 8-year-old with his leg over his 3-year-old brother trying to protect him? They'd have never been war criminals like Cali if everybody spoke Vietnamese.
I am convinced 100% that the people, all the people that our company killed when I was a CO were not all Viet Cong. I know that. But we tried to avoid killing innocent people, and that's such a tricky thing, because it depends on the situation you're in, what happened to you a couple hours earlier, how's your day been, have any of your friends died recently. That's all going to affect how you react to a situation. These things come up. They're fleeting instants, fleeting moments, and sometimes you just have to react. As a soldier, you have to shoot or not shoot. And most of the time, you shoot.
So I think there's this sudden realization that this wasn't just a fight against totalitarian communism. This was a really ugly war against the people of Vietnam, in which we were killing not abstract communists, but real human beings who were not communists, who were not political at all, but who were just concerned with saving their lives and living at peace.
Unless the war in Vietnam was ended, a lot of people would be hurt, a lot of people would be killed unnecessarily. There was no way to end the war without humanizing the Vietnamese instead of demonizing them.
People can talk about politics, they can talk about all they want and about ideology within the 60s generation. But a heck of a lot of people in the 60s generation just did not wish to have their lives interrupted and going off to a someplace far off that they didn't care about, and holding the line against the Great Red Horde.
The idea of flying off to Vietnam to save somebody when we couldn't save our own neighborhoods and our cities seems sort of preposterous.
All of us, basically, who are not serving when a crisis happens, we're kind of parasites living off the heroism and the courage of those who give their lives for someone else.
Is that patriotic? For a government to lie to its own people, take their money and taxes and the blood of their sons. You see, when you get into these issues of patriotism, there's no end to it. It might be the most American thing to do to say no to a government that lies and wants to take your son to die or be wounded in a cause that is unclear.
58,000 of us died. And basically, the area was given up on a political whim. The left hand in America didn't like the idea, and we lost our first war, not on a battlefield, but right here.
When I see Ho Chi Minh still spoken of respectfully by a Bill Clinton or somebody who chanted, ho, ho, Ho Chi Minh will win, and LBJ, how many babies did you kill today? Those people were pulling for communism to win, and they've got the, what are they gonna pull today, for terrorism to win?
What would we have won? We didn't have any right to be there. We didn't have any right to win anything, except maybe our salvation by getting out.
There's an interesting thing that goes on in American politics, which is also frightening, and that is the decisions made by American presidents to send young men to war because of their own political needs. And you see it with John F. Kennedy. He thinks if he takes troops out of Vietnam, that this will show him as weak and this will cause him to lose the 1964 election. And then Lyndon Johnson seems to understand that people are going to die in Vietnam as a result of continuing American military action in Vietnam. He said, but if I withdraw from Vietnam, won't I be impeached? In other words, Johnson is putting his political future ahead of the lives of Americans and of Vietnamese. This is a very, very disturbing thought. But when you look at the history of American presidencies, especially in the 20th century, you see how often political considerations enter into life and death decisions made by American presidents. And this is something that I think should be very troubling for anyone who believes in democracy.
The point, however, is that the Vietnamese are still there, and we still have a role to play in the world. And are we served by fighting future wars based on mythology of past wars, or would it be better to absorb the more painful lessons of the past wars?
I think it was an understanding that if you don't talk about it, we won't talk about it. Let's just, this 500-pound elephant in our living room, let's just walk around it.
I didn't talk about being a Vietnam veteran, but I didn't run from it either. I was only then developing my attitudes about the war. I basically just shut down, didn't want to have any thoughts about it, didn't want to see myself as a Vietnam veteran per se. I had a lot of anger.
Basically, after Vietnam, I didn't want to hang around with veterans. I had become anti-war. And I didn't even want to hear somebody talking about, we should have done this or shouldn't have done that. I just didn't want to hear it. It was like poison to my body.
In a post-traumatic sense way, when I spent some time in the VA hospital in group sessions and whatnot, you know, it was a very cathartic moment that was coming home. That in all those years, I was never able to say, hey, you know, this was like hurting me.
I went to a rap group with other vets and just started talking about the bombings and what I saw. And I just completely broke down for 2 days, weeping, my whole body shaking. It was the horror coming back. And it comes back even at this moment. And I know every time the United States gets involved in a foreign policy intervention, I see those bodies, none of which deserve to die.
It's very hard to simply forget about the Vietnam War because it's such as, it was, you know, the longest war the United States had fought. And the Vietnam veterans are still here, they're with us, they're all around us, and so very hard to forget about that war. Therefore, the only question is, you know, how to remember it. There are strenuous efforts being made by the government and, with, to a great extent, the complicity of the media to give the Vietnam War a more heroic look than it had at the time, so that the United States can carry on wars again without facing the kind of opposition that they faced during the Vietnam War.
Ever since I came home from Vietnam, I had a need to say, hey, look what you're doing here. Look at the damage you're causing. Look at all the people who are suffering. Our side, their side, everybody's side. If we don't learn that lesson at some point, you know, I think we're all going to suffer in the future for it.
Nobody's worth any more than somebody else. Nobody. Nobody's worth any less.
I learned this from Vietnam, and I'm not giving it up because my service there has to be for a reason.